want to be sure and acknowledge that this land upon which we gather this morning has been walked for generations by the Anishinaabeg peoples, the Neutrals, the Hodsinigi Confederacy. It is covered by Niagara Purchase Treaty 381. Our service continues on page 185, Book of Alternative Services. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
First reading is Isaiah. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord has called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward is with my God." And now the Lord says, "Who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God has become my strength." He says, "It is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach the ends of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and his Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, the slave of rulers. The king shall see and stand up. Princes, and they shall prostrate themselves, because the Lord is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you." Discover what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
this morning appears on page 4 of your bulletin and will say the verses alternatively. I waited patiently upon the Lord. He stooped to me and heard my cry.
He lifted me out of the desolate pit, out of the mire and clay. He set my feet upon a high cliff and made my footing sure.
He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many shall see and stand in awe and put their trust in the Lord.
Happy are they who trust in the Lord. They do not resort to evil spirits or turn to false gods.
Great things are they that you have done, O Lord, my God. How great your wonders and your plans for us. There is none who can be compared with you.
Oh, that I could make them known and tell them, but they are more than I can count.
In sacrifice and offering you take no pleasure. You have given me ears to hear you.
Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required, and so I say, hold my heart.
In the roll of the book it is written concerning me, I love to do your will, O my God. Your law is deep in my heart.
I proclaim righteousness in the great congregation. Behold, I do not restrain my righteousness, and that of the Lord you know.
Your righteousness have I not hidden in my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your deliverance. I have not concealed your love and faithfulness from the great congregation. Together let us pray. God our Savior, hear our prayer for all who suffer at the hands of others, and especially for those who suffer for the sake of justice. Raise and comfort them, and lead us all in the paths of loving service. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen.
Second readings from the book of Corinthians. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes. To the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that is given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind. Just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in a spiritual gift, as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Discover what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thank you. I speak.
Lord, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with the water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water says to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I speak to you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Our gospel passage from John's gospel begins with John the Baptist describing Jesus as the Lamb of God. He will, a few verses later, declare that Jesus is the Son of God. Why then did John describe the Messiah as the Lamb of God? And what significance does this have for us today? I want to acknowledge the commentary of Jean Vanier, author of Drawn into the Mystery of Jesus through the Gospel of John, that helped me with this homily. To understand the use of the term Lamb, we have to understand the mindset of the Jewish people in the first century. They would have been aware from the Hebrew Bible and stories of faith of the significance of that word. Remember that God had promised the great patriarch Abraham in Genesis 22, verse 17, that he would be the father of many people, more numerous than all the stars of the sky. But he and his wife Sarah had not had any children. And in her advanced age, Sarah conceives, and she and Abraham have a son, Isaac. Yet God tests Abraham and asks him to sacrifice his son. Abraham and the boy Isaac go up to a mountain carrying wood and a knife for the sacrifice. In Genesis 22, verses 7 to 6, Isaac asks, "Father, the fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham replies, "God himself will provide the lamb, my son." The writers of Genesis then go on to tell us that Abraham ties Isaac up, puts him on the wood prepared for the fire, and raises his knife to kill him. An angel stops Abraham and acknowledges that Abraham fears God. A ram miraculously appears and is sacrificed instead of Isaac. We go forward in time. In the book of Exodus, we find Abraham's descendants, the Hebrew people, enslaved in Egypt. Moses, as prophet of God, warns Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to let my people go. The answer is no, and despite several plagues, there is no change. God sends the angel of death to kill the firstborn of Egypt, but saves his people Israel. The people slaughter a lamb and paint their portals with his blood. They are spared, and they roast the lamb over the fire, and today they still mark this as Passover. Years later, as the children of Israel return from captivity in Babylon, the prophet Isaiah writes about Jesus, calling him, quote, "He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. He bore the sins of many and made intercessions for our transgressions." Now, the Son of God is, of course, born. He's born as an infant in a stable. He is as helpless as a lamb. There's no fancy nursery, you know the story, just straws, Joseph, and some livestock. Humble shepherds will leave their sheep to be the first to greet him. He will be raised in a household of a carpenter and probably learns the trade. At about age 30, he leaves Galilee and seeks out John the Baptist. John will baptize him, and John describes Jesus as the Lamb of God. Jesus will then spend 40 days in the wilderness before beginning his earthly ministry. What a strange beginning for the Messiah. He did not come as a warrior in chariots surrounded by avenging angels. If Jesus had entered in that spectacular way, there would be no doubt who he was. The angels would destroy mighty Caesar and his legions. All the evil would be cast into hell, and all the world bowed down in worship. Instead, this helpless infant becomes a man, and as the Lamb of God, he will change the world forever. As we read in the Gospel today, he would begin to call followers, called Andrew and Peter. He would begin a ministry that showed compassion, kindness, and mercy. He would heal the sick, eat with sinners, and associate with outcasts. He would preach a gospel of love and mercy. He would willingly submit himself to torture and a terrible death because he was the servant of God. However, he would rise again to show all of us that the ultimate penalty of life, death itself, is not an end. He would demonstrate that it in fact can be a new beginning, a new and permanent relationship with God the Father forever. So why is this significant for us that Jesus was called the Lamb of God? Jean Vanier writes, and I quote, quote, "In front of the power and armies of Caesar, in front of their mighty weapons, stands a lamb, the Lamb of God. What can the lamb do? The lamb will break down the walls of fear, of aggression, of violence, of sin which imprisons people in themselves and incite them to seek their own glory. He will liberate in each person a new life of communication with God, with other people, and what is deepest in the self, setting seeds for universal peace." End of quotation. John's description of Jesus as the Lamb of God is not only rooted in scripture and tradition, but describes the kind of Messiah that Jesus will be. So what does that mean for us today? I hope we are all here this morning with a thirst to have a relationship with God and to try as best we can to model our lives as a result. In Handel's glorious work, The Messiah, Earlier verses describe Jesus as Almighty God, everlasting King, and Prince of Peace. He could have entered the world as a mighty warrior king, but he did not. We are therefore urged to model ourselves and our lives on one who came to serve. How do we do this? Let us remember that we are in a new year and time to set new and personal agendas. First, let's note the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, because they tell us that after his baptism, Jesus went into the wilderness. It is implicit that in this time he prayed and was in dialogue with the Father. Throughout the Gospels, there are constant stories of Jesus wanting to be alone and in prayer with the Father. The last famous incident was in the Garden of Gethsemane before his arrest. It is also clear that Jesus considered this exercise to be critical. Therefore, I suggest we need to begin with prayer. It is important that we thank God and raise our petitions and requests to God. However, it is just as important that we be in dialogue with God and strive to listen to his still small voice. Scripture and the community of each other, either in worship or in simply sharing our faith journey with others, is critical. Note that in today's gospel, Jesus did not, even though he was the Son of God, try to do it alone. No, he began with the process of calling disciples and living in a community of faith, setting what would later not only involve the 12 disciples, but other followers like Mary Magdalene. We can sit down and examine ways of how we do this. Attending worship, gathering in groups like Alpha or Crucio, or in parish events are other methods. But we need to focus on what we do to serve the Lord. Please, look at the treasures we have. Most of us came to church this morning in warm cars, or if we walked, we had warm clothing. We probably had breakfast already, or we'll attend brunch after service, if we can get it in before the ball game. We came from warm houses. I suggest that now it is time to sit down and plan how we share our treasures. How much and to whom will we be able to donate our financial resources? I do hope that the church is high on your list, but there are certainly many deserving charities, health organizations, and educational settings that will use your money for good works. I hope you will agree with me that this should be planned and given serious, prayerful thought. We all have gifts or talents. Are you able to sing or play a musical instrument? Are you handy with tools? And could you help here? By the way, don't ask me. Or with Habitat Humanity, maybe you could help them, or with your neighbor to fix that problem. Are you able to help on events like Feed the Soul or produce wonderful food for a bazaar or coffee afterwards? Are you able to drive a car and take people to medical appointments? Can you be an advocate for social causes or simply help a sick person navigate the health system? Or perhaps you are simply an empathetic listener who can always be there. The use of the term the Lamb of God was a wonderful way to describe the Messiah, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It also, I believe, calls us as those who would follow Jesus to model ourselves on the way Jesus would have done it. Remember the second great commandment that Jesus gave us, to love our neighbors as ourselves. Jesus simply asks us to try. About 754 years before Jesus was baptized and called the Lamb of God, the prophet Micah wrote something really profound. In chapter 6, verse 7, Micah wrote down his belief on what God would have us do. The prophet wrote, and I quote, "He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and love kindness, to walk humbly with your God." Amen.
you are able, please stand, turn to page 188 of the Nicene Creed. Let us confess our faith as we say. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death. Doug, our Premier, Jim, our Regional Chair, and Wayne, our Mayor. We ask your blessing on all members of the Legislative Councils and Assemblies and all Justices, and pray that you guide them with your Holy Spirit so that they reflect your will in all that they say and do. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for this troubled planet, our island home. We pray especially for the areas of the world where there has been natural disasters, tornadoes, floods, fire, and famine. We pray for areas of the world in conflict, and we ask your blessing upon all who work as volunteers and non-governmental organizations to make this a better place. This morning we pray especially for the Ukraine. God of peace and justice, we pray for the people of the Ukraine today. We pray for peace in the laying down of weapons. We pray for all those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to. We pray for those with power over war or peace, for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. Above all, we pray for all your precious children, at risk and in fear, that you would hold and protect them. We pray in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for our local community. We give thanks to everyone that makes Fort Erie a wonderful place to live. We ask your blessing upon municipal employees, upon those that maintain our utilities, upon our teachers, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who's will be remembered tomorrow in the United States. I give you now the opportunity, either silently or aloud, to pray for those who have died and those who are. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Dear friends of Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our enemies as ourselves. We are truly sorry. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may be led by your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As you're able, would you please sit? Peace of the Lord be always with you. Through the prophets, you renewed your promise of salvation. Therefore, with them and with all your saints who have served you in every age, we give thanks and raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. But we'll need reports from folks who are responsible for producing reports, yours truly included. And we'll have a vestry meeting following the 11 o'clock service on February the 12th. So do keep that in mind. And I don't expect it to take too very long. I'm not one for letting people grind their respective axes at a vestry meeting. There are other avenues for that process. So just keep that in mind. Hopefully we'll be in and out without too much fuss. Prior to the vestry meeting, though, we're planning a dance and a lounge and an opportunity to kick up our heels and relax and have some fun and listen to some lovely music. And learn something at the 8 o'clock service, actually, because it is a non-alcoholic function. There's a fellow who's moved into the area who has just opened a business, or is just about to, right beside the hardware store out on Dominion Road, right on the corner of Crest Road, who is going to be selling non-alcoholic beer and wine and other various potables that reflect their alcoholic cousins, but are of a non-alcoholic nature. And so, yeah, so that's just in the process of opening up. I guess he's going to be opening very soon. Brian Barrington was telling us at 8 o'clock. And so, yes, we'll have some interesting refreshments that we can include at that event. So that's a happy thing. Tickets are $15 a person, and just contact the parish office.
There's a phone number.
Oh, sorry, there is.
Yes.
And is that right to you? That's right.
Yes,
right to Catherine and Chris. So there's the number for tickets. That's so that we know how many chairs to set up. And there's only a couple of weeks left before they're going to be making tortillere. And if somebody is interested in helping and perhaps learning about making tortillere, this would be a great opportunity. Shall they contact Catherine at that number as well? Is that the thing to do? Sorry? She's the number for questions. I would think if people want to volunteer and help and learn, that might be.
I'll come over.
Yeah. All right. Very good. Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm getting things mixed up because that.
Hold on. That's okay.
Gee, none of us ever did that this morning, did we?
I'm sorry. I'm seeing the picture of the tortillere and then the note there, but the note above actually is about the note on the.
What a duo we are.
Good thing we don't have to have any more church services today. At least I don't. All right, wait. Pardon? I mean, when you have food, you generally draw more people, right?
Absolutely.
And you get through the vestry meeting faster because people want to eat.
People want to eat. So it's certainly something to talk about. Oh, look, there's going to be a coffee hour. We can talk about it.
Yeah.
Anything else that would be good?
Well, and speaking of coffee hour, please don't forget to bring goodies. They don't appear on their own. Secondly, Feed the Soul happens a week from Wednesday. We had to, Linda wisely canceled the one after Christmas because folks couldn't get out of their driveway. It would have been dangerous for the people to try to come. I have some good news. news for you. On Friday, Lori and I drove up to Hamilton. We had the strange phenomena of hitting Sodom Road, and then the snow started. 50 kilometers an hour through Niagara Falls and St. Catharines, and I almost was late for my medical appointment. The good news is I don't need back surgery. There are other ways of doing it. So thank you for your prayers and kind thoughts. I'm going to be, in the prayers, I mentioned a gathering of deacons with the bishop. Traditionally, we each had one gathering a year, a dinner in the spring. And Bishop Susan, in dialogue with myself and Sheila Pond, decided there needs to be an additional one where she actually can have a chance to talk to all of us and find out what we're doing. And that comes up this Thursday. So pray for us, please, as we gather together. I think that's everything.
Anything else that would be good for the rest of us to hear? All right, well, if you'd stand, we'll have a blessing, sing another hymn, and carry on with Sunday. Hold fast to your faith, that it may move you to act with integrity and promote justice. Choose kindness and dare to love. And the blessing of God Almighty, Holy Creator, Christ, and Spirit be with you and work through you among those whom you love, today and always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.